Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Murder at Work by Faith Martin, narrated by Alison Campbell. Chapter 1. It was nearly 6 o'clock, and the evening in early May was trying to be mellow, but not quite succeeding. Detective Inspector Hilary Greene glanced out of her office window at the view across the village of Kidlington, looking towards the city of Oxford, but it was too far for her to pick out many of the fabled dreaming spires. Either that, or she needed glasses. And with the big 5-0 looming on the horizon, she supposed gloomily that the latter was a distinct possibility. With a sigh, she made a mental note to visit the opticians once she was retired. She shifted uneasily on her chair and forced herself to repeat the phrase in her mind yet again, once she was retired. It was funny, but no matter how many times she forced herself to use the phrase, she still couldn't make it stick. But leaving she was, and soon her last day at work would arrive with the usual little celebratory drink with her colleagues, followed by a few uncomfortable speeches and a gold watch. Or whatever the modern equivalent was these days. Maybe then it would finally get through her thick skull that her working career as a cop was over. There were many things that Hilary was determinedly scheduling for when she retired. They ranged from the sublime to the ridiculous. From a long list of boring chores, such as the latest addendum, the eye test, to setting off on her narrow boat, the Mollern, for a long, leisurely tour of Britain's waterways. Well, those that were still navigable anyway. Thing was, she wasn't sure which way to go. West and into Gloucestershire, maybe up through Wales, or south, maybe get on to the Thames. Not that she really fancied ending up in London, cities were not her favourite thing. Maybe she should just head north, follow the canals till they ran out, then turn round and come back again. For some reason, the aimlessness of this agenda, instead of imbuing her with a sense of freedom and spontaneity, left her feeling just a little flat. Sometimes she indulged herself with the fantasy of maybe writing a book, probably fiction, possibly crime. After all, a lot of other cops had done the same and been successful. True, that happened more often across the Atlantic than at home, but so what? At other times, an extended holiday in a more exotic clime clamoured for consideration. A world cruise? A safari? A tour across Asia, being careful to avoid backpackers and students in their gap year. But more often than not, the chief thing she felt whenever she contemplated her early retirement from the Thames Valley Police Force was a vague and cool uneasiness that could border on dread. With a mental sigh, she snapped shut the folder she'd been reading, which was DC Mark Chang's report on the hijacking of a lorry near the Pear Tree roundabout, in which a batch of computers had gone walkabout. The constable clearly suspected an insider in the computer firm, and Hilary agreed with him. Someone in the firm must have tipped off the hijackers, especially since the routes were always varied, and even the drivers got shuffled around at the last minute without warning. She couldn't fault the firm's managing director in his attempts to keep the business's insurance bills down, and he must be spitting nails at this latest setback. She wondered, idly, how much the shipment had been insured for, contemplated an inside job combined with insurance fraud, then felt her interest wane. It was really Gemma's case anyway. She was merely keeping a watching brief. Since she'd handed in her notice 2 months ago, she'd gradually been dwindling down her workload in preparation for leaving. The last thing she wanted to do was leave with too many cases outstanding. She had too much professional pride for that. She got up and reached for her jacket. A rich dark green, it matched her slender skirt and complemented the cream blouse she was wearing. The whole ensemble suited her longish, bell-shaped cut of dark chestnut hair. And since she'd lost nearly a stone in weight during the last couple of months, she attracted more than her usual share of male glances as she made her way out of the large open-plan office and down the stairs into the foyer. She went to the reception desk, where a hefty desk sergeant, counting down the minutes until he was relieved, saw her approach and grinned a welcome.
"Can't say as I miss that old DC of yours," he said affably, by way of greeting. "You know, that long streak of wind with the ginger mop. He was all right usually, but the last few weeks he was going about with a face like a long wet weekend."
Hilary smiled wryly. There was no point in explaining that Keith Barrington, who'd left the force a few weeks ago to join his lover on the pro tennis circuit, had certainly had more than enough on his plate to warrant the long face. Keith was gay and had been in the closet. Having a wealthy boyfriend had not exactly been an asset to a young DC with ambition. The son of a titled man and recently convicted felon, the boyfriend had ambitions to be the next Andy Murray, and the suicide of his father, whilst being held at Her Majesty's pleasure, had given him the opportunity to go chasing his dreams. He'd been determined to take Keith with him. Not surprisingly, Gavin Morland had no love for the police, and had probably been determined for some time to winkle the love of his life out of the arms of the men in blue and into the more rarefied atmosphere of the well-to-do, footloose and fancy-free brigade. Hilary still secretly believed her young constable had made the wrong choice in leaving the force to become a sports agent, but she was hardly in the position to advise anyone on anything, either on matters of the heart or career options. Hadn't her own choices landed her in the position in which she now languished? With no other option but to resign, and with the prospect of a boyfriend about as remote as her becoming the next lottery winner. "I had a postcard from him earlier this week," Hilary responded to the desk sergeant's jibes. "From Monte Carlo, I think it was, where it's 10 degrees hotter. He was sipping pina coladas by the pool and pocketing a nice little check after bagging his second signing, some minor league football hopeful who's just been bought up by Swansea." The desk sergeant blew a raspberry.
"Swansea? Who the hell cares?"
But he had a faraway look in his eyes that looked a lot like envy to Hilary, and she was careful to hide her smile. "See you tomorrow, Bill," she said dryly, and turned towards the large, modern set of swing doors that led out to a featureless car park. The desk sergeant watched her go and sighed. No two ways about it. It would be the end of an era when Hilary Greene left. He still couldn't believe that she was actually going. Nobody could. Everyone kept on thinking that something was going to happen to change her mind, but so far she was staying grim-faced and stoical, and her leaving date grew slowly but inexorably nearer. Outside, Hilary made her way to Puff the Tragic Wagon, her ancient Volkswagen Golf, and wondered what she'd do with the car if she did take to the canal system for any length of time. It hardly seemed worth garaging it somewhere, but on the other hand, she was loath to sell it. Over the years, she'd grown used to it, and it seemed like one wrench too many to say goodbye to the contrary old rust bucket. She shivered in the cool evening air as she fiddled with the door lock. Once inside, she switched on the ignition and turned the heater up to full. Not that it would do much good, she realized philosophically. She only had a 5-minute drive at the most ahead of her. By the time she reached the small hamlet of Thrupp, just on the outskirts of Kidlington, the heater might just have started to blow lukewarm air onto her toes, if she was lucky. She didn't know it, but from his window on the top floor of the building, the newly promoted Commander Marcus Donlevy was watching her leave, his grey eyes darkening as they followed the progress of her car until it was out of sight. Then he went back to his desk and pressed the intercom switch. He knew that his secretary, who could have left at 5, would still be at her desk. She always waited for him to leave first, unless there was some sort of crisis on and he was pulling an all-nighter.
Can you ask DCI Danvers to come in, please?
There was a murmur of consent and then static. Marcus sat back in his chair, steepling his fingers together in an unconscious habit that told anyone who knew him well that he was thinking hard and planning something. A few minutes later, there came a knock at the door, and a handsome, fair-haired man walked in. He was in his late 30s, and when he greeted his chief, he spoke with a soft Northern Yorkshire burr. DCI Paul Danvers had fancied Hilary Greene ever since he and another detective had been assigned to investigate Ronnie Greene, Hilary's late and unlamented husband, for corruption. Everyone knew that Danvers's partner had had his suspicions that Hilary must have known about Ronnie's illegal animal parts smuggling ring, but she had, of course, been cleared of all suspicion. But it had hardly been the best of introductions for Danvers. Hilary was hardly likely to look kindly on a fellow detective assigned to investigate her own private and financial dealings. It hadn't helped that Danvers was several years younger than her either. Or prettier, as she'd once been overheard to say to someone at the office Christmas party. Marcus Dunleavy waved the man into a chair and smiled across at him. He was wearing his trademark silver grey suit and an electric blue tie. With grey eyes and silver hair, he looked as though he'd just stepped out of an advert for a Savile Row tailor.
"Paul, all set for the move?" he asked amiably.
Paul Danvers nodded warily.
"I've been packed up and living out of boxes for the last few weeks, sir," he said flatly. "Yes, sorry your transfer was delayed. You know how it is."
Danvers smiled wryly. He knew.
"But I've just got the final piece of paperwork confirmed,"
Dunleavy continued smoothly.
"You go at the end of this month." "Good. The lease on my flat runs out on the 1st of June, and I didn't fancy trying to rent a bedsit in Oxford to see me through."
Marcus shuddered.
"Perish the thought."
He smiled.
"No, don't look so worried. It's not your transfer that I wanted to talk about."
Danvers relaxed marginally and began to look less wary and more curious.
"It's Hilary," Marcus said. "She's still determined to go."
"Seems so," Paul said, with real regret.
He might have accepted that he and Hilary, as an item, were never going to happen, but he still cared very much about what was happening to her. When he'd left Yorkshire for Thames Valley, he'd been determined to press for the job as Hilary's immediate boss, and since then he'd pursued her carefully but determinedly, without success. Eventually, when he realised that his obsession with her was interfering with his work, he'd taken the decision that it had to stop, and, biting the bullet, he'd applied for a transfer back to York. He'd been as shocked as anyone the day she walked into his office and handed in her resignation. He still didn't understand it. Hilary was a workhorse, and a woman so suited to her job that they seemed joined at the hip. He'd racked his brains to think of any reason for her decision, but had come up empty. It was deeply frustrating. He wasn't alone. All of her friends and colleagues had tried to talk her out of it. Her only response was tight-lipped silence and a refusal to budge.
"And she still hasn't given you any real explanation?" Dunleavy demanded.
"No. She's sticking with her story. She says that with her team disintegrating and after Mel's death, she just feels it's time to go,"
Danvers said quietly. And there was probably some truth in what she said, Paul mused. Her team had sort of crumbled around her recently. First Keith had left to chase the good life. Then her sergeant, the super-efficient kick-ass Gemma Fordham, had announced her marriage, to a lord, no less. It was hardly surprising that she'd consequently been promoted after passing her boards and was off for pastures new, chairing the latest brainchild of the chief constable. He rather doubted that Gemma, a martial arts expert, would be doing much hands-on work from now on. Riding a desk and learning all about paperwork, budgets, and conferences was probably going to be her lot from now on. He'd discussed this with Hillary, who was sure that Gemma still hadn't cottoned on to what her latest promotion truly meant. And once she did, Hillary was sure there'd be fireworks. But, as she'd pointed out to Paul with a dreary sigh, that wouldn't be her problem anymore.
I know she thinks the new boy, Chang, is shaping up nicely, but he's still wet behind the ears, and he's hardly going to make up for Barrington and Gemma, is he? Paul pointed out.
That's just an excuse,
Don Levy said dismissively.
I've got a whole line of officers lined up who'd jump at the chance to work with Hillary. Sam Waterstone, for a start, and he and she have always got on.
Paul nodded.
Mel's death did hit her hard, he pointed out.
Marcus sighed. DCI Philip Mello Mallow had been Hillary's best friend and immediate superior officer for nearly 15 years, before he'd been killed in front of Hillary's eyes less than a year ago.
She's solved two murders since then, Marcus pointed out. She took leave and got herself sorted out. She's too much of a fighter to let the bastards wear her down. No, it's nothing to do with Mel. That much at least I'm sure of.
Paul Danvers shifted uneasily on his seat. He had a nasty idea he knew where the commander was headed with all this, and he didn't want anything to do with it. He was heading back home, a little heart sore, and maybe with a hint of his tail between his legs. But for all that, he didn't want complications now. But under Marcus Donlevy's grey, heavy-lidded gaze, he felt compelled to speak.
You still think it's Vane's fault? He asked reluctantly.
Detective Superintendent Brian Vane had replaced Mel as Hillary Greene's superior, and it had proved to be a disaster within a very short time. Marcus, who'd learned too late of some of the reasons behind Hillary and Vane's mutual antipathy, shrugged.
I can't see what else it can be. The inquiry into Janine Mallow's shooting of Myers cleared both her and Hillary of any culpability, and the publicity was never centred on Hillary anyway.
Paul nodded. Janine Tyler had been Hillary's sergeant in the old days, before she'd married Philip Mallow and had his daughter. When she'd shot dead the man who'd killed her husband in somewhat uncertain circumstances, Vane had accused Hillary of somehow covering up for her. It had been the first public sign of the depth of Vane's antipathy towards Hillary, and it hadn't gone unnoticed.
But Vane's off to Old this month, isn't he? Paul said. So Hillary knew that he'd be out of her hair. All she had to do was wait.
The powers that be didn't take kindly to superintendents who rocked the boat when there was a delicate and very public inquiry going on. An officer of Hillary's experience would know that. Marcus sighed heavily.
You and I both know Hillary Greene's one of the best investigative officers we have around here. She's even turned down promotion so that she can continue to be SIO on the big cases. It's in her blood.
Paul promptly agreed. So far, Hillary Greene's success rate on homicide cases was second to none.
That's why I've called you up here. It's come to my notice that Hillary's winding down her caseload, passing it on to Gemma or Sam Waterstone or anyone else who's willing.
Paul frowned.
Well, that makes sense. She's leaving in 3 weeks, so she wouldn't want to be in the middle of anything big. You know the kind of headache that's involved in handing over a complicated case.
Marcus Donlevy smiled grimly.
Indeed I do. That's why I want you to assign her to the next big case that comes up.
Paul Danvers opened his mouth to protest, then caught the steely glint in the commander's eyes and snapped his jaw shut.
Yes, sir, he said, after a moment's silence.
He knew as well as Don Levy that Hillary would hate to leave in the middle of an unsolved murder case. But would it be enough to make her postpone her leaving? For some reason, Paul Danvers doubted it. Don Levy nodded with a brief smile of satisfaction. He was known at the Nick for getting his own way, and now Danvers understood why. With a sigh and a premonition of trouble ahead, the Yorkshireman left his boss's office. It was pitch black at midnight. The moon, which had previously been full and beaming a cold, frost-laden gleam across the ground, had suddenly been swallowed up by cloud, and the temperature was beginning to rise just a little. This was a fact which Frank Ross, night watchman at the Ainhoe Islip Business Park, was only too happy to acknowledge. Not just because it made his nightly rounds that much more comfortable, without the cold biting at his hands and face, but because of the loss of the light, which would make his main task of the night that much easier. He shone his torch onto his watch face and stood in the centre of the large, messy, modern yard, glancing around. The business park, newly and purpose-built on the outskirts of the village of Adderbury, which was itself a near suburb of the large market town of Banbury, was silent and dark. The nearest houses, an estate of modern little boxes on the north border, were also reassuringly dark. No little squares of light suggested that someone was abroad for a midnight pee, or that a mother was up with a teething toddler. Although it was unlikely that they'd bother to look out of their windows in the middle of the night, Ross still felt better on seeing that the darkness was almost complete. There was no street lighting here, of course. The six unit holders had voted not to have the added expense, although their insurers had insisted on some security, hence Frank's meagre pittance of a wage. Still, for once, Frank had reason to be glad of the stinginess of the business park's owners. Not only had it provided him with a job, if it could be called that, he snorted to himself, but it had given him the opportunity to indulge in a nice little earner on the side. Any time now, he thought, glancing again at his watch. The lorry was due in at 1 a.m. He could do his rounds before then, he supposed, and make sure that everything was shipshape and all locked up nice and tight. The thought made him laugh. But on the other hand, why bother? Nobody but himself ever got up to anything in this dead-end hole. But there, as it so happened, Frank Ross was wrong. Dead wrong. It was not, it has to be said, an altogether unusual occurrence. Hillary Greene had no idea what woke her. Everything was dark, and the boat was still. Occasionally, some mad boater would cruise the canals in the dark and cause the Mollern to rock gently but with some protest at her mooring. Usually, boaters who had a pressing need to be somewhere had miscalculated the time needed to arrive at their destination. There was a 4 mile per hour limit on the canals, and newcomers to the narrowboat fraternity could be caught out. Mostly the offenders were holidaymakers, who needed to get their hired boat back to the boatyard before their 14 days were up. Hillary shuddered at the thought of how expensive boats were to hire, and she usually felt a sneaking sympathy for those who needed to travel in the dark to avoid swinging late penalty fees. But the night was quiet, and the boat was still. She supposed it could have been the call of an owl that had woken her. She knew there was a nesting pair of tawnies in the small wood beside the canal. She sighed and rolled onto her side, the familiar and comforting scent of the canal drifting in through the small round porthole above her bed. She faced the facts. It wasn't the owls that had awoken her, just the usual malady. For the past few weeks, she'd been finding it hard to get a full night's sleep. A psychiatrist would hardly need to break sweat to point out the reason why. She sighed, rose, and made herself a cup of hot chocolate. She glanced at her wristwatch as she sat back on the edge of the bed, drinking it. It was 2 minutes past one. She sighed. In Adderbury, Frank Ross heard the first faint rumble of the lorry engine. He walked quickly to the large double-width gate that covered the entrance to the park. The whole park was surrounded by chain-link fencing, nearly 15 feet high and topped with razor wire. The gate was also alarmed, the control panel being placed in Frank's warm control booth, which was set a few yards back from the main entrance. He'd turned off the systems from there barely 5 minutes ago. Now he waited until he could see the small lorry's indicator flashing orange in the night. Then he opened up the padlock and pulled the gates across. It made a lot of noise, and he glanced around instinctively. But the distant houses remained dark and incurious. Even if some insomniac was aware of the activity in the park, he doubted it would arouse suspicion. It was a business park, after all, where business and industry were conducted. And with the recession still biting, people worked where and when they could, sometimes even in the middle of the night. So there was nothing unduly suspicious in that. Frank nodded to the driver as the lorry pulled up in front of Unit 4. A metal inscription over the entrance to it bore the legend Hodgson and Sons, and showed up clearly in the headlights. Frank locked and closed the gate, careful to refit the padlock. He grinned as he did so. After all, he didn't want any of the local thieves butting in on his action and bringing unwanted attention down on them. He watched as two men jumped from the back of the lorry, one of them with the keys to the builder's yard's private entrance. Frank had no such keys to any of the businesses, which was just how he liked it. It meant that no one could say he had access to the premises themselves. Just in case things turned nasty, it was nice to have full deniability. It was his job to patrol the public areas of the park and report anything suspicious to the police. Nothing more. Frank went back to his comfortable booth. It wasn't his job to do manual labour either, he thought with a cocky grin, as one of the men shot him a dirty look. Hillary turned off the light and closed her eyes. It was nearly 2 a.m., and she doubted she would sleep now. Instead, she began to plan the exotic holiday. The Seychelles, maybe. Or one of those islands that was going to be swamped when global warming finally caught up with humanity. Better see it now, while it still existed. The fact was, she'd sold her house years ago, when property was booming, and the money had been sitting in the bank ever since, earning interest, when interest rates had been high. Furthermore, she'd worked out a mutually agreeable middle path with the pensions office, which would see her drawing enough money each month to tide her over without too much scrimping, providing she didn't go buying any diamond tiaras. So she was, according to most people's estimation, relatively well-to-do. She also now owned the Mollern outright, since buying it from her uncle, so her overheads were low. She could do anything that she wanted, within reason. So why the hell couldn't she sleep? Frank Ross waved the lorry goodbye, metaphorically rubbing his hands with glee over the thought of his cut. It would enable him to back a few winners at the racecourse, pay for a few prozzies, and see him drinking Stella Artois at his local for a couple of weeks easy. He relocked the gates and headed back to his booth. There he turned the security systems on again and settled down in his chair. The dim, internal lighting glowed a pale green, giving his face the look of a drowned man. He poured himself a cup of coffee from his thermos, settled himself down on his chair, and closed his eyes with a small smile of well-being. Hillary Greene was up at 5. Dawn was gleaming through the willow trees, and the clouds of the night were reluctantly giving way to a pale rose pink. In Adderbury, Frank Ross, too, began to stir. He poured the last of the coffee from his thermos, grimacing at the tepid, stewed-tasting liquid, and took the plastic cup outside, where he stretched, scratched his groin, and looked around. It wasn't fully light yet, but he couldn't be bothered with the torch. More to stretch his legs than anything else, he began to do his rounds. Because of the layout, he started at Unit 6, a large auto repair shop, and went in a semicircle back towards the entrance. He passed various businesses as he strolled casually in the sharp dawn air. Doyle's, a scrap metal yard, earned his careful attention. There was a lot of money in scrap metal nowadays. If they could find someone inside who wanted to earn a bit of extra cash, perhaps he and the boys could do some business of their own. After all, a lorry could leave carrying metal as well as building supplies. He whistled thoughtfully, barely glancing at the shoe depot that provided trainers and high heels to half the shoe shops in the home counties, then made his way back to the beginning and his booth again. The last of the premises, Unit 1, belonged to a newspaper delivery depot, which specialised in local papers. They were due to receive a big delivery of Banbury cakes, the newspaper, not the famous comestible, within the hour. Luckily, he went off at 6, and it would be Billy's job to let them in. He peered over the top of the high wooden gate that was the entrance to the lot, and frowned as he noticed the light spilling out of the ground floor window. Shit! Surely nobody had been working late in the office? Frank felt a cold sweat break out at the mere thought of it. Because of the angle of the building and the height of the gate, the light hadn't been visible from the booth. He cursed as he realised that he should have done his rounds just before midnight after all. Then he'd have spotted this potential problem. The depot was surrounded by rough wooden fencing about 6 feet high, and as he leaned on the gate, he felt it move easily with his weight. He realised it was slightly ajar. Damn and double damn! It was the sort of thing he was supposed to notice and report. He had a list of telephone numbers for all the unit holders, and he was supposed to report possible problems to them in case of emergency. He pushed the gate open slowly.
Hello there, it's just me, Frank Ross, night security.
His voice sounded a shade thick and uncomfortable, but nobody answered. And after a while, he let his breath out in a shaky sigh of relief. Some careless twit had simply forgotten to switch off the lights and shut and lock the gate behind him, that was all. And why not? It wasn't as if anyone was going to nick 100 tons of tabloids, was it? Besides, didn't the park have good old Frank Ross to make sure that no ne'er-do-wells pilfered any goodies? Frank glanced around the faceless block of the unit. Unattractive orange-yellow bricks stared back at him. There were very few windows in the building, and those that had been installed were mostly on the ground floor near the front. Almost certainly they indicated where the offices were. Vaguely curious, Frank walked up the path and veered across a scrubby lawn towards the lit room. There he cupped his hands to the window and looked inside. An empty, seemingly normal office looked back at him. Frank shrugged. He'd make a note of it in his log, backdated, of course. He'd say he noticed all this on his first round, just to cover his arse. He turned and stopped dead. In a patch of shadow provided by a bank of shrubs that had been planted to relieve the unrelenting brickwork and tarmac, he could see a definite shape on the ground. Slowly, Frank, an ex-copper, walked towards it, already half knowing what it was. He began to swear softly and comprehensively all the way across the patchy piece of grass until he was standing just a few feet away. On the ground in front of him lay the body of a man. It had a red mess where one side of his head should be, and lying beside him on the ground was a short plank of wood with nails sticking out of it. The wood had probably come from the builder's yard. No matter how old man Hodgson tried to keep his area of the park tidy, there were always stray bits of wood, sawdust, nails, and what have you, littering the ground area around Unit 4. Anybody could just pick them up. The nails on this particular piece of 2x4 were sticky and red. In the growing dawn light, Frank recognized the corpse at once. He carried right on swearing and sweating. Chapter 2. Hilary Greene pulled out of Thrupp onto the main Oxford to Banbury road and hit the worst of the rush hour traffic just after crossing the railway bridge a scant minute later. At this time in the morning, the traffic going into Oxford made even her tiny commute a matter of patience versus stress. Behind her, a man in a Mercedes talked illegally on his mobile phone, and Hilary sighed heavily, trying to catch his eye so that she could glare at him in the rearview mirror. Would the idiots never learn? If they'd had to attend as many RTAs as she had when she was still in uniform, they'd think twice. Hilary had only had to see one mangled body being dragged from a crushed car to promise herself never to drink and drive, a promise she'd never yet broken. And she never used mobiles whilst driving either, always pulling over whenever she felt the need, or, more often than not, when its annoying trill summoned her. She wound down the side window and breathed in the cool May air. Then she coughed on exhaust fumes from the laden Volvo in front of her as it revved on the accelerator. She quickly wound up the glass again, swearing wearily. Grimly, she told herself that when she retired, she wouldn't have to suffer even this inconvenience. From now on, she'd start listing all the good points about leaving the force whenever they occurred to her. Somehow, it didn't fill her with optimism. The traffic moved another couple of feet, then stalled, and she patiently eased Puff the tragic wagon onwards. 10 minutes later, she was passing by the Kidlington Library, the sight of which reminded her to make sure that all her books were taken back before she left. Then she winced as a young boy on a bicycle cut in front of her, narrowly missing going under the wheels of a taxi idling at the traffic lights. He was in school uniform and probably late for class. She wondered, idly, if she'd ever get out of the habit of noticing petty wrongdoers. She somehow doubted it. She eventually made it to the large car park outside Thames Valley Police HQ and made her way across the crackling asphalt to the main doors. Once inside, she held up a hand to acknowledge the desk sergeant's greeting and headed up the stairs. She never took the lift, and thanks to her recent loss of weight, arrived on the second floor without too much unsightly puffing. She had barely pushed through into the large open-plan area where she and the team worked, however, before she noticed the door to Paul Danvers's cubicle shoot open. He stepped halfway outside and beckoned her in. Instantly, she diverted from her progress towards her desk and, once outside his door, poked her head round it. "Paul?" Danvers reached across his desk and picked up a piece of paper.
"This is Justin, a suspicious death at a business park in Adderbury."
Hilary stayed firmly by the door, making no move to go further inside, let alone reach for the slip of paper.
"And you're waving it around at me, why, exactly?" she asked.
"You know I go in 3 weeks' time. Even if it's just an industrial accident, the case could drag on longer than that." Nearly all unexpected deaths reported to the police were designated as suspicious until checked out. Most turned out to be the result of accident or suicide rather than murder, of course. But this time her spider sense was tingling,
and she eyed the piece of paper in her superior officer's hand with a mixture of loathing and longing.
"You're up," Paul insisted.
Hillary blinked.
"You've got to be kidding."
She heard the hint of a whine in her voice and inwardly cringed. Hastily, she modified her voice to a reasonable grumble.
"I'm winding my cases down, not looking for a major new one. Can't Sam take it, or DCI Rollinson?"
"They're busy,"
Danvers lied, and shook the piece of paper impatiently.
"Come on, don't take all day about it. The sooner you're started, the sooner you'll be finished."
Hillary snorted at that piece of useless logic. She reluctantly took the details and headed back to her desk. As she walked, she thought it over, and it didn't take her long to figure out what was behind it all. Paul, who was due to go back north himself any time now, wouldn't have assigned her the case off his own bat. And Superintendent Brian Vane would rather slit his own throat than hand a potential murder case over to Hillary. Which meant it had to go even higher than him, which could only mean Don Levy. And that made sense. Hillary gave a mental smile and shook her head. She had to admire the man's tenacity. At first, he'd refused to accept her resignation. Then he'd had her in his office almost every day for a week trying to talk her out of it and get to the bottom of her decision and reasons to leave. She had, of course, kept her mouth firmly shut about those. The less Don Levy knew, the less he'd have to worry about. As it was, she was not sure that the sky wouldn't come tumbling down around her before she had the chance to go. A lot of it rested on the shoulders of that incongruous pair, Detective Superintendent Brian Vane and D.I. Janine Mallow. And the last thing Hillary wanted to do was to bring down trouble on her colleagues and the job she loved. She'd quite like to leave with some dignity intact, if it could be managed. Since Don Levy had been rather quiet lately, she'd hoped that he'd finally accepted the inevitable and was resigned to the loss of what he considered to be one of his more able detectives. She should have known better. As she approached her desk, two heads swiveled her way. They couldn't have been more different. One was female, topped with spiky blonde hair so pale it was almost white. Gemma Fordham, still languishing in the rank of sergeant until she started her new job as DI out near Aylesbury, watched Hillary approach with a question in her eye. She had obviously scented the hint of excitement that was even now making Hillary walk with a lighter step. She was wearing her usual trademark trouser suit, today in a dark chocolate brown, and her voice, left husky after a childhood accident, came clearly across the space as Hillary approached the desk.
"Gov, what did Danvers want?"
The other head watching her was dark and belonged to a man of rather startling male beauty. DC Mark Chang's black eyes sharpened at the look of grim amusement on his boss's face. "We have a suspicious death out near Banbury Way," she said, her gaze encompassing them both. "Get your stuff. Gemma, take Chang's car. No need to add to our carbon footprint by turning up in three vehicles. And no doubt we'll be out there all day." Gemma grunted, but glanced at the clearly excited young Chang with a more or less affectionate eye. It was his second big case, and she could just about remember what that felt like. Hillary waited at the exit to the car park until she saw Chang's respectable and reliable little hatchback pull up behind her, with Gemma, not surprisingly, at the wheel. Gemma Fordham was definitely the sort who liked to be in control, and although protocol had it that the junior officer always drove, she couldn't see Gemma relinquishing her place behind the wheel, no matter whose car they used. As she drove north towards the large market town of Banbury, she wondered, with just a hint of despair, and not for the first time, just what she could get Gemma for a wedding present. Her wedding was due at the end of May and was to be held at a large and prestigious church in North Oxford. Her groom was a blind and well-heeled music don who had lately come into a title. And therein lay the problem. She could hardly turn up with a set of bog-standard crystal glasses or a set of superstore-bought tableware. Something antique, perhaps? But she wasn't sure that her sergeant was into that kind of thing. Maybe something off the wall, police-related memorabilia, perhaps. That way the cost of it would be immaterial. Mind you, that was hardly a good choice for nuptials. She sighed in defeat and pushed the problem to one side. She was now consulting the piece of paper that Danvers had given her, which was now lying on the passenger seat beside her, when she was stopped by a red light at Hopcroft's Holt. The Ainho Islip Business Park. It was a somewhat confusing name, she thought with a frown. She knew the village of Ainho could be reached by turning right at the village of Adderbury, but Islip, another anciently named village, lay many miles away, and in the opposite direction, not far from Oxford itself. She gave a mental shrug. Oh well, it shouldn't be that hard to find. And in that, she was quite right. Adderbury was one of those odd places in which only a small part lay on a major road, in this case, one that linked Banbury to Oxford. Consequently, the majority of people passing through it only saw a fraction of the village, the pub on the main road and the newly built houses near the set of traffic lights. The rest of the settlement lay out of sight down a dip in the road, but it was one of the prettiest of Oxfordshire's villages that Hilary knew of. Perhaps if she had a moment's peace during the day, she'd drive through it and reacquaint herself with it. She turned right at the traffic lights, figuring that the Ainho Islip Business Park would actually be on the road leading to one of the named villages, and found the entrance to it about a quarter of a mile from Adderbury itself. It was marked by two police patrol cars parked either side of it. She pulled up in front of the further one and climbed out. She was wearing a dark blue skirt and matching jacket and a pair of flat, sensible shoes. Another thing to look forward to in retirement, she could wear pretty shoes. She smiled wryly at the thought and glanced across at the uniformed constable who was standing stiffly beside his patrol car as she approached. He looked young and self-important and obviously didn't know her. Before he got the chance to ask her to move along, she spared his blushes by reaching for her car.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.